The United Nations will gratefully remember the truly heroic figure of this war. He is G.I. Joe. He has surmounted charges into desperately defended beaches. He has fought his tedious, patient way through the ultimate in fortified zones. He has endured cold, hunger, fatigue. His companion has been danger. Death has dogged his footsteps. He and his platoon commanders have given us an example of loyalty, devotion to duty, and indomitable courage that will live in our hearts as long as we admire those qualities in men.
You didn't ask me about my political beliefs. If I was a socialist when you drafted me into the army, and the German mortar crew that fired at me didn't ask me about my political beliefs when they fired at me, they just fired. And the army doctors never asked me about my political beliefs when they amputated my legs. So what right have you got now to tell me that I'm going to be fired because of the fact that I'm a socialist?
They asked me, of course, how tall I'd been before I lost my legs, and I told them they asked me if I would like to be taller or shorter. They said they could make me almost any size I wanted to be. So they made me 5 feet 4, I believe. I was 5 feet 4 before. I didn't think it was such a good idea to make myself taller. My father came over here in 1905 from Russia. My mother a few years later, and I was born in 1912 in Newark, New Jersey. I graduated high school in 1933, right in the middle of the Depression, and started looking for a job, and there just weren't any jobs to be had. Oftentimes, for non-payment of rent, people got evicted out of their apartments. They would come in, move the furniture out on the sidewalk. Sometimes if you had an unemployed organization, the unemployed organization would come along and move the stuff back in for you again. I mean, it was like a seesaw battle between the unemployed workers and the landlords. As the Depression deepened, the Roosevelt administration, trying to deal with some of the worst aspects of it, created a school for unemployed teachers. And I thought that it was a good chance for me to get to learn something. So I went to the school, and at the school I ran into some students who were socialists, and they brought me around to some of their meetings, and the first thing I knew, I joined the Socialist Party. Later on, a faction fight developed over the political policies being followed in the Spanish Civil War.
I joined the revolutionary faction, and when they split in early 1938, I went along with them, and we organized the Socialist Workers' Party.
In the world. The third is freedom from want, which translated into world terms means economic understandings which will secure to every nation a healthy peacetime life for its inhabitants everywhere in the world. The fourth is freedom from fear, which translated into world terms means a worldwide reduction of armaments to such a point and in such a thorough fashion that no nation will be in a position to commit an act of physical aggression against any neighbor anywhere in the world.
Roosevelt's pitch about leading this country into a war for four freedoms was a fake and a fraud from beginning to end. He was already preparing to curb democratic rights in this country in order to strangle opposition to the war policy of the ruling class. In 1940, the Smith Act was put on the books. It was a thought control law that was designed to frame up anybody that spoke against the war on the grounds that they were conspiring to overthrow the government by force and violence. I was one of those 18. We were leaders of the Socialist Workers' Party and the Teamsters Union in Minneapolis. We were put into a situation much like that occurred to around 100 leaders of the industrial workers of the world back in the First World War, when they were tried in mass and convicted under the espionage law of that time. The prosecution paraded FBI informers and agents on the stand one after another, and their pitch was to claim that we said one thing in public, in our press and our public speeches, and we said another thing in private. That in our public speeches, we said we were against the war and gave reasons for being against the war. But in our private speeches and talks, we said that the whole object was to overthrow the government. Well, they convinced the jury on that basis that we were guilty, and Roosevelt succeeded in framing us up.
But the real purpose was that the Roosevelt administration, I'm sorry to say, wanted to do a favor for Dan Tobin and the Teamsters, and they were anxious to drive out these militant independent activist labor leaders in Minneapolis who were led by the Trotskyists. So the Smith Act was an excuse to drive out these honest trade unionists in Minneapolis and supersede them with a kind of racketeers and bums that have been so prominent in the Teamster leadership ever since.
Then the draft came along and I was drafted into the Army, and even though I asked for a few months deferment so that I would be able to finish the course at this school, that was denied me. So I went into the Army in 1941. Now, I knew before I went in that the party was opposed to the draft, opposed to the war. Personally, I was opposed to all these things, too. I was sent overseas in November 1942 and landed in Africa. I fought in the African, Sicilian, and Italian campaigns. But all the way up the Italian peninsula, I was weary, you know. We just marched and marched and fought and fought. The Germans had contested every foot of the way. I was wounded in Italy at a mountain called San Pietro. I was wounded by a mortar shell. It was And late afternoon, after we'd been marching all day and we had stopped for a couple of hours, and we managed to get some sleep, and after sleep, I awoke and I said to my companion, I said, I think it's time to eat. So we stood up to reach into our knapsacks, and then the thing hit me. It felt like being hit in the back of the legs with a baseball bat, somebody sticking up on you and hitting you as hard as he could.
I found myself sitting on the ground, dazed, stooping forward, and surrounded with a pool of smoke, and began to call for a medic, but it wasn't until after dark that medics finally came, and I asked him about my companion. He didn't say anything, so I thought that my companion was probably dead, and he was. The first field hospital that I came to, the doctors looked at me and they said that you would have to lose both of your legs.
Began as just another day, but to a single B-29 over the Japanese city of Hiroshima, it was the beginning of a new era for civilization. At 8:15 in the morning found a 400-pound bomb with a destructive force of 20,000 tons of TNT mushrooming up over the stunned enemy city. To the frightened inhabitants, the end of the world had come.
Store windows are once more blossoming as they did before Pearl Harbor with every gadget dear to Americans. And by the thousands, people are flocking to automobile display rooms for a preview of the new automobiles. 60,000 visited one sales room in 5 days for a peek. Now we'll have our rewards of victory. Peace, it's wonderful.
For the workers in this country, the very first thing they got as a reward at the end of the war was massive layoffs. War production was cut back in basic industry. No sooner was the war over than a massive strike wave exploded. It was the biggest strike wave that ever occurred in this country.
Striking merchant seamen on the nation's west coast touch off a shipping tie-up that soon becomes nationwide. The walkout threatens to halt the work of 400,000 cargo handlers and seamen in the United States. Tugmen also join the strike and refuse to tow the vessels to the piers where pickets carry banners asking dock workers not to cross the line. The city's truckmen, also on strike, further complicate the transport situation. A bottleneck to the world's economy shapes up. The wheels of the country's railroads grind slowly to a halt as 250,000 trainmen and engineers walk off the job. The nation's main arteries of transportation are cut, and America's march toward reconversion suffers another crippling setback.
They tried to keep the American military forces abroad in huge numbers after the war ended. But the rank and file soldiers in the Army had different ideas about it. And when the Pentagon didn't demobilize them, they organized massive protests around the world. When they came back, they went right on the picket lines with the workers into the unions instead of the capitalists being able to use them against the unions as they had hoped. The veterans were standing shoulder to shoulder with the workers in fighting for their rights.
The action which I have already taken and the action which I shall ask you to take are necessary for the preservation of our government. That action is also necessary to save the great and mighty masses of working men and women from the dangerous effects of the ill-advised and misguided acts of some of their own leaders. I request temporary legislation to take care of this immediate crisis. I request permanent legislation leading to the formulation of a long-range labor policy designed to prevent the recurrence of such crises and generally to reduce the stoppages of work in all industries for the future. As a part of this temporary emergency legislation, I request the Congress immediately to authorize the President to draft into the armed forces of the United States all workers who are on strike against their government.
Well, when I first came out of the Army, I hadn't completely made up my mind as to just what I was going to do. I was looking for something and trying to make up my mind when a representative of the Veterans Administration came to my home, and I asked them if they would have anything like a job open at the Veterans Administration in Newark. He said, yes, I could get a job in the VA in Newark if I wanted to. Well, I went to work for the Veterans Administration in August 1946.
In making the concessions economically to the workers that were forced upon them by the strike wave, the monopoly corporations in this country were simply trying to calm down the labor movement while they went ahead with their plans to dominate and exploit the whole world.
President Truman addresses a joint session of Congress on our changing foreign policy.
The very existence of the Greek state is today threatened by the terrorist activities of several thousand armed men led by communists. It must be the policy of the United States to support free peoples who are resisting attempted subjugation by armed minorities or by outside pressures. I therefore ask the Congress to provide authority for assistance to Greece and Turkey in the amount of $400 million for the period ending June 30th, 1948. In addition to funds, I ask the Congress to authorize the detail of American civilian and military personnel to Greece and Turkey at the request of those countries to assist in the tasks of reconstruction and for the purpose of supervising the use of such financial and material assistance as may be furnished. If we falter in our leadership, we may endanger the peace of the world, and we shall surely endanger the welfare of this nation.
Washington is under a virtual state of siege during the closing hours of the Taft-Hartley labor bill fight, as forces of labor stage last-minute demonstrations to defeat the measure. At the White House, storm center of the fight, attendants look at a record-breaking avalanche of mail, mostly urging veto of the bill to curb labor power.
The whole campaign carried on against the new labor bill by the labor unions has been a complete tissue of falsification. To support their contention of the last 10 years that unions are above criticism and above the law, and that there must be no legislation on the pain of political execution.
And even as Senator Taft and Representative Hartley congratulate each other on victory in the Congress, labor leaders vow a fight for repeal and vengeance at the polls in 1948.
And their next steps were to develop the Cold War, the ultimate objects of which were to crush the uprisings of the colonial peoples that developed after the war, and in the end, to conquer Soviet Russia and to create the impression that the new fight was against godless communism.
It is my duty to place before you certain facts about the present position in Europe. From Stettin in the Baltic to Trieste in the Adriatic, an iron curtain has descended across the continent.
President Truman followed up on Churchill's Iron Curtain speech by launching a witch hunt in this country.
Inside the House office building in Washington, eager spectators who have waited since early morning crowd the 400-seat caucus room to see and hear star witnesses from Hollywood.
Are you a member of the Communist Party? Or have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
It's unfortunate and tragic that I have to teach this committee the
basic principles of Americanism. That's not the question. The question is, have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
I'm framing my answer in the only way in which any American citizen can frame his
then
answer
you denied,
to a question
then
which
you,
invades his absolutely invade.
Then you deny to you refuse to answer that question. Is that correct?
I have told you that I will offer my beliefs, my affiliations, and
everything else
to the American public, and they will know where I stand, as they do from what I have written.
Stand away from the stand.
I have written for Americanism for many years, and I shall
stand away from the stand.
Fight for the Bill of Rights, which you are trying to destroy.
I'll take this man away from the stand. Are you, or have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
I believe I have the right to be confronted with any evidence which supports this question. I should like to see what you have.
Oh, well, you would.
Yes.
Well, you will pretty soon. The witness is excused. Impossible.
This is the beginning
typical
of
communist tactics. Typical communist tactics. Typical communist tactics.
Are you now, have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
It is perfectly clear to me, gentlemen, that if you continue in this particular fashion, you have only one
answer the question.
And that is to cause strife in the industry,
you're excused.
Chaos in the industry,
and you direct the witness to answer that question. The first major act was the issuing of a so-called subversive list. Without any prior notice, a whole series of organizations suddenly learned through the press that the government had declared them subversive. The Socialist Workers' Party was one of those organizations. And one of our first major victims of that witch hunt was James Kutcher.
Good afternoon. This is Chet Huntley speaking for HFC. There's a man sitting across this table from me at this moment. His name is James Kutcher. He's a veteran. His legs were left on an Italian battlefield. After getting out of the hospital and after the war, James Kutcher went to work as a clerk in the Veterans Administration, far removed from any matter or information dealing with national security. Now, Mr. Kutcher is a member of the Socialist Workers' Party. He said so when he filled out his application for the VA job. The loyalty program was initiated, and the Attorney General of the United States then listed the Socialist Workers' Party as a subversive organization. Consequently, Mr. Kutcher was dismissed and is now in the process of appealing to the courts for reinstatement.
Well, when I received this letter from the loyalty board threatening to fire me, I went to see a friend in the party and asked him what I should do.
I remember when Jimmy came up to the house and there were a few of us around and we talked to Jimmy about what we should do about fighting the government's attack on him. And we told him that it was up to him to decide whether he wanted to make a case of it.
I could either resign and try to get another job, which would mean only that I resigned under investigation, or I could deny membership in the party and have them prove that I was, or I could make a principled fight of it and admit to membership and challenge their right to fire me on that basis.
I really couldn't believe it at first. I mean, here was a man who had fought in this damn war and lost both his legs, went through the whole travail of being fitted with the artificial legs, learned how to get around on them, took the civil service test, and finally got his first steady job before the war, the Depression, there were no jobs. And it was pretty much of a Mickey Mouse job, a file clerk. There was no security involved or anything.
Yeah, but he liked that job. It was a good job.
Thing.
Yeah.
Of course. If you never had a job, any steady job looks good. And that job was important to Jimmy. But I must say, my first reactions was not about all of the big political issues that were involved, as we learned later. But what a rotten, outrageous, dirty goddamn thing it was that they had done to Jimmy.
Referring directly to the dangers of the Red Philosophy, Mr. Marju has this to say about witch hunting.
I'm a witch hunter if the witch is a communist. I'm a red baiter. Make no bones about it whatsoever. I'd like to see them all in Russia.
I believe that the entire nation should be alerted to its menace today.
It is completely against the un-American feeling, this communistic thing. I believe I would move to the state of Texas if it ever came here, because I think the Texans would kill them on sight.
I was afraid not only for myself, for my parents, because my when the thing came out in the newspapers, my parents' neighbors started to accuse them of being communists. You know, and my father, in all his life, was never active in any political organization. So I had to take that into consideration, deciding to fight. And still, I felt, you know, that it was important for somebody to stand up and say enough of this.
A proposal to make communists in America register as agents of a foreign power is brought before the House Committee on Un-American Activities by Representative Carl E. Mundt.
One of the first American industries to recognize the imperative need for the adoption of a national policy by Congress with respect to the employment of communists and other subversive elements was the motion picture industry. But neither that industry nor any other can compete the job of cleaning communists out of its midst until Congress acts. My bill will publicly identify the communists of this country for the foreign agents that they actually are, and enable both public and private employers to be on guard against them.
In mobilizing support against witch hunt attacks, there are very important principles to be followed. The central aim must be to arouse people to the fact that they're facing a common danger and that it's necessary to act in unison, in solidarity, in common defense of the democratic rights of all.
We wanted to appeal and solicit the support of Americans of all opinions because the issues involve them as well as Jimmy Kutcher and his party.
The organization, in this case the Socialist Workers' Party, in the Kutcher case, would have been foolish to take advantage of the fact that Kutcher, the victim, was a party member in order to make political points for the party. The object is to defend democratic rights, not to seek factional political advantage, one organization against another.
The most important shield in any defense case is publicity, so that we didn't want to have his hearings behind closed doors, his appeals simply made to the administrative officials involved.
They told me of an extraordinary situation of a man who had lost both of his legs serving the United States in the armed forces, and that he had been dismissed from his job. It aroused not only my curiosity, but my feeling of bitterness, because I personally am also a veteran. And I said to myself, I got to see this man, I learned where he was, and I called him on the telephone, introduced myself, and said, I'm coming up to see you. This story, which I wrote, was sent to many veterans organizations, one of which was the Jewish War Veterans, of which I was then a member and still am. I do not recollect what activity the Jewish War Veterans or any of the veterans groups took, but I know some of them did, because an imposing list of famous celebrities, including Nobel Prize winners and a man by the name of Condon and many others, went to the forefront to fight for Kutcher.
We took his letter of protest to a press conference in Newark, New Jersey. And at that initial conference, we had representatives of the New Jersey trade union movement, representatives of the religious group, and other people who were concerned about civil liberties. And that broke the story both in the state and nationwide.
I had been fighting the witch hunt, and when the case began against Jim Kutcher, I seized on it as a way to show the ultimate absurdity of the whole witch hunt. Here was a $39 a week clerk in the Veterans Administration, hardly a place in which to steal government secrets. The veteran was a Trotskyist, hardly going to be an agent of the Kremlin. And the poor guy had no legs to get around on, and I wrote a piece about it called The Case of the Legless Veteran for the New York Daily Compass, in which I ended up by saying that even more pitiable than a veteran, a legless veteran, was a president without principles.
He was accused under the government order of advocating the practice of force and violence. He replied very appropriately that he didn't believe in the practice of force and violence, and the only time he engaged in violent action was under orders in the United States Army.
But in my own thinking, the story that I wrote, I said to myself, there's something cockeyed about all of this in this respect. The world listens too much to the opinions of people who sit on board. They sit on their fannies, and what the hell do they know of what actual life is? They listen to opinions. Whether they actually ever read the platform of the Socialist Workers' Party, I doubt. So they listen to some lawyer or some stooge telling them what they should do. Are those the people that should have been listened to, or should a different group of people should have been listened to? I felt that the people whose opinion were the really important ones were those of the buddy of James Kutcher.
And there it was quite natural he should appeal to the most prominent of his fellow veterans. He asked his support from Harold Russell, the armless veteran who had been featured in the film The Best Days of Our Lives. We asked for support from Bill Malden, the GI cartoonist, and others. They readily responded.
As far as I know, Jimmy's was the first case where it was fought out on a clear and open and principled basis, where he said, yes, I am a socialist. I am a member of the Socialist Workers' Party, and I've got a right to belong to the Socialist Workers' Party, and I've got a right to work anywhere I please, including for the United States government.
Well, the people who were supporting my case thought that they had made a terrible mistake in firing me, and they felt sure that if I made a personal appeal to President Truman, that he would intercede in my behalf. And so in order to satisfy these people, we wrote the letter reminding him of what he had said. He had made a number of speeches about the veterans, saying that nothing is too good for these people. I explained to him what had happened and asked him if he would restore me to my job.
I hope you're having a pleasant and instructive visit here, and that you carry back to your great country an opinion of this country that will continue our friendship forever. We are anxious, as you are, for a friendly and peaceful world all the way around. Must be a communist in the bunch. Interrupted me at the psychological moment.
Realized that what they had done was a very conscious and deliberate thing. They intended to scare hell out of people in this country, shut people up. And they decided, I think, to make as dramatic an example as they could, to take a man who had lost both his legs in the war. They had a very ordinary job, there's no question of security being involved or anything, and firing him for nothing else than for being a socialist. Well, I'd had to make people stop and think. If they were willing to do that to this kind of a guy, what would they do to other people?
At that time, there was a tremendous hysteria in the country. There was such a situation under Truman, who is today regarded as a great liberal Democrat. He may have been, but there was a thought control policy which was in effect.
Truman, who was basically a liberal, took fright. And in order to combat the anti-red hysteria against the Democrats, before the 1948 elections, set up the government employees loyalty program, and thus aided and abetted the witch hunt.
Howard Petrick.
the employee lawyer of the program 3 years ago. 3 years ago, with two objectives in mind. I was determined, as far as it was humanly possible, to see that no disloyal person should be employed by our government, whether he was a communist or a Native American fascist of the silver shirt or Ku Klux Klan variety. I was equally determined that loyal government employees should be protected against accusations which were false, malicious, and ill-founded. And that's just as important as the other part of the program. Not a single person who has been adjudged to be a communist or otherwise disloyal remains on the government payroll today. Now I'm going to tell you how we're not going to fight communism. We're not going to transform our fine FBI into a Gestapo secret police. That's what some people would like to do. We're not going to try to control what our people read and say and think. We're not going to turn the United States into a right-wing totalitarian country in order to deal with a left-wing totalitarian threat. In short, we're not going to end democracy. We're going to keep the Bill of Rights on the books.
Under the loyalty program, the normal judicial procedure was completely reversed. Instead of going into court with the assumption that you're innocent until proven guilty, they had that thing turned all around, and you were accused of being guilty, and you had to go into court to prove that you were not guilty.
But you have no idea of the fear that was in people's heart when they were being accused of being a communist. They would shiver in their boots, their pants would fall down, terrible visions would go into their mind, their jobs would be lost, because all you had to do was to be denounced as a communist was you were seen holding a Russian newspaper. That automatically made you a communist. And if you had had the temerity to ever read Karl Marx or to go to any lectures where the Karl Marx theories were being discussed, automatically you were a communist. And the boards, they didn't give a damn to investigate. Your name was put in the mail on a piece of paper. Bloom was seen reading such and such communist literature, or he had a Russian dictionary in his hand, or his grandmother who came from Russia, she paid him a visit. Automatically, you would be put on some sort of a list, and a fear would result. You didn't know what in the world could happen. That's the actual situation. It's hard to believe, but that's what happened.
This was the scene of communist military jubilation in Shanghai, China's largest city, in late May of 1949. The Nationalist Army was so weakened and cut up by the rapid advance of the Reds, they hardly had time to retreat and prepare for the next line of battle. The Nationalists took what they could and fled across the Formosa Strait to protect what was left of their government. On September 21st, 1949, the People's Republic was proclaimed in the city of Peking. The Reds had swallowed China.
A Senate subcommittee investigates sensational charges by Senator Joseph McCarthy. He claims that the State Department has 57 communists on its payroll. One of the accused is John Stewart Service, now summoned home, and concerning whom Senator McCarthy says,
Mr. Chairman, today this man, John S. Service, is a ranking officer in the policy-making group of untouchables on duty in Calcutta, India, one of the most strategically important listening posts in the world today, and since the fall of China, perhaps the most important new front of the Cold War. He was not an acceptable risk under Mr. Acheson's own yardstick of loyalty the day he entered the government. He is not a sound security risk today.
Now, one thing ought to be made perfectly clear about this McCarthy period. It wasn't just the Jimmy Kutchers who weren't safe. Nobody was safe. The high and the mighty went down along with the lowliest of citizens. I spent my life working on that kind of a problem. I represented Lillian Hellman and Arthur Miller, two people who were singed by this
terrible McCarthyism. They were probably the most prominent playwrights in America, and if people could get at them, think what they could do to Jimmy.
The whole purpose of the witch hunt was to try to intimidate everybody. The government wanted everybody to conform to us and think only in a certain way.
And of course, the reductio ad absurdum of the whole damn witch hunt was the Kutcher case, because here, if the excuse for the witch hunt was the fear of Soviet agents and the government, here were the Trotskyists, the most bitter and principled and unrelenting foes of the Stalinist dictatorship. They would hardly act as agents for the Kremlin. So that they were made a target on which J. Edgar Hoover, who now turns out to have been quite a nut, quite a paranoid, wasted millions of dollars, literally millions of dollars, infiltrating the Trotskyists.
Well, after the case was about a year old and gotten some publicity, they decided it would be a good idea for me to go on tour and get further publicity and further support. First, Novak went on tour and spoke about the case in a number of places and came back and told me that there was a lot of interest every place. He said he never saw anything like it. Then it was arranged for me to go on tour. I was hesitant at first, but after it was explained to me what would be involved, you know, I said, let's do it.
Jimmy now had to do many things that he had thought he wasn't capable of doing. He had to speak at public meetings. You can imagine how difficult that was for him. He had to hold press interviews, appear on television, talk over the radio. But he was the kind of a person that was capable of self-discipline, of driving himself to do what he thought was necessary, and he went out and he did all these things.
Unions were the ones who contributed the most money to my case. I must have spoken to hundreds of union bodies during the course of the fight. A local of the Ladies' Garment Workers Union fitted me out with a new suit of clothes and a top coat. And they even suggested fitting me with clothes for life, but that was too much. I wouldn't accept that. Everybody was on my side. I didn't find anybody hostile to me except Stalinists. The Stalinists always attacked us. I mean, the Socialist Workers' Party always had a principled position on the defense of civil liberties, and even though they attacked us, we defended their civil rights just as a matter of principle.
And at the time, I warned my communist friends. I said, look, they're going to get you guys next. But they were so wedded to sectarianism and their silly 1939, I think it was, Constitution, which forbade party members to fraternize with Trotskyists, that the Daily Worker actually applauded the first prosecution under the Smith Act because it was a prosecution of the Trotskyists. And then, of course, within 10 years, they themselves got it in the neck.
A federal court deals a body blow to American communism. In New York, one of the longest criminal trials in U.S. history ends with a verdict that the 11 top American Reds are guilty of criminal conspiracy against the government. The 11 condemned communist leaders faced up to 10-year prison terms if their appeals from the sentence are denied. Their indictment was for violating the Smith Act in teaching or advocating overthrow and destruction of the government of the United States. Taken off to jail, they announced plans to contest the constitutionality of the Smith Act as prohibiting the freedom of speech.
It was a beautiful example of the fact that if you fail to man the outer ramparts and defend the rights of small minorities, sooner or later it's going to engulf larger groups and the majority itself.
There's only one way to fight, and that is on an absolutely non-partisan, non-factional basis, mobilizing everybody you can in defense of democratic rights for all.
My name is Ronald Reagan. Last year, the contributions of 16 million Americans to the Crusade for Freedom made possible the World Freedom Bell, symbol of hope and freedom to the communist-dominated peoples of Eastern Europe, and built this powerful 135,000-watt radio Free Europe transmitter in Western Germany. Grateful letters from listeners smuggled past the secret police express thanks to Radio Free Europe for identifying communist quislings and informers by name. The Crusade for Freedom is your chance and mine to fight communism. Join now by sending your contributions to General Clay, Crusade for Freedom, Empire State Building, New York City. Or join in your local community.
We arranged a meeting with Attorney General Clark. We had an interview in his office at the Justice Department. He said that lots of people were being subjected to the purge. He says nobody else was protesting, nobody except you. He says, why do you keep going around with all this protesting and so forth? Why can't you be like everybody else and just submit to the thing? And I said that people are not protesting because they're afraid. And
the world is tired of political fanaticism. It is sick of the kind of political allegiance which is inspired solely by fear. Men want to live together in peace. They want to enjoy that great privilege, the privilege denied to millions throughout the world today, the right to think their own thoughts and to have their own convictions.
It's time for the Longines Chronoscope. Our distinguished guest for this evening is Mr. Farrell Dobbs, National Chairman of the Socialist Workers' Party.
Mr. Dobbs, it's been our Chronoscope policy to present to our audience all of the presidential candidates this year, and since you are a candidate for your party, I'm sure that our audience will welcome your views tonight. What is your party's position on foreign policy?
Our party's position is that the war in Korea should be stopped. And how the American troops should be brought home.
How would you stop it without letting the Russians take over the entire country?
Our position is that the United States should take the lead in advocating that every nation pull their troops out of every country, whether they're as foreign troops. And once that is done, the peoples in each of these countries can settle the problems themselves. And that's the way it should be done. That's the way it should have been done in Korea in the first place.
Well, people thought that if I didn't get a response from Truman, that I might still get one from Eisenhower. So we wrote a letter to Eisenhower, too. Having done that with Truman, we decided to give Ike a chance to reinstate me. But we never received any answers from either Truman or Eisenhower. I wrote to Eisenhower in the spirit of one veteran talking to another. But he didn't answer. The government also passed a new housing oath. I and my parents lived in a government low-cost housing project, and my father would have had to sign the oath saying that nobody in the apartment belonged to any subversive organization. And with me fighting my case, he couldn't sign such an oath without perjuring himself. So then we received some help from the American Civil Liberties Union. They hired a Newark lawyer who took over the housing case. Since there were a lot of those cases being tried at that time, the judge decided to withhold the decision until the Supreme Court made a ruling on it.
Someone had passed America's atomic bomb secrets to Russia. This was an undisputed fact that the whole world knew. The federal government had laid the crime at the doorstep of two native New Yorkers, Julius and Ethel Rosenberg. Their trial had excited interest all over the world. The two admitted Communist Party members knew that they faced possible death sentences in the event of their conviction. But to the end, they both protested their innocence of the theft. In April of 1951, the federal court of Judge Irving R. Kaufman found the pair guilty as charged and sentenced them to death in the electric chair to pay for their crime of treason. World Communism set up an organized demonstration against the sentence. They uttered the cry of anti-Semitism, claiming this as the basis for conviction rather than irrefutable facts. The communists were not the only protesters in the uproar raised by the two spies' conviction. Famous and respected men such as Albert Einstein put their signatures to petitions demanding a new trial. A final appeal after 2 years of stays of execution was refused by President Eisenhower. The Rosenbergs, he said, betrayed the cause of freedom and have been accorded their full measure of justice.
A second tour was arranged for me, and I didn't get the open support that I got the first time from the labor movement. On my first tour, they just couldn't do enough for me. Now I guess the government's pressure was being felt very heavily by these labor leaders, and they were not as eager to put themselves out, you know, in organizing a defense as they were at the beginning.
Some people have asked why we intellectuals couldn't have waged a better fight against the witch hunt. And my answer is that intellectuals never have a mass base. Our normal mass base would have been the working class and the labor movement. But an important part about the witch hunt is that the leadership, a large part of the leadership of the labor movement, used the Cold War and the witch hunt to further a jurisdictional dispute and drive left-wing unions, communist or Trotskyite, out of the labor movement, so that they collaborated with the witch hunt.
The witch hunt was beginning to become violent. The labor leaders were afraid of being branded as communists themselves if they allowed me in. I remember coming to one union meeting and standing outside the door and listening to argument going on inside, and one person said, if we admit him, we'll be investigated by the FBI and so forth. And so they voted against having me.
We never talk of workers' rights. There's no more Reds in the union. They tell us that it leads to fight. There's no more Reds in the union. Our leaders, they have always said that folks that talk like that are Red. We listen to the boss instead. There's no more Reds in the union. Each year we have a big affair. There's no more Reds in the union. The bosses and their wives are there. There's no more Reds in the union. They give us food, they give us beer, but one thing does seem mighty queer. We eat that good but once a year. There's no more Reds in the union.
I felt discouraged a lot of times because nothing was happening in the case. We even had a convention of the party, and a whole convention went by, and nobody said a word about the Kutcher case. And I didn't know what the party was going to do. I didn't know what the government was going to do. I felt very discouraged, very downhearted about that. But I was wishing that, you know, something would happen so that I would be noticed again. It seemed like everybody simply had forgotten about me. I received a letter from the Veterans Administration saying that they were going to revoke my pension, and then I began to feel afraid that they would take all my other benefits away too. My legs, stump socks, insurance, and all the things that veterans are entitled to. That really blew the lid off the whole case. There were big headlines in newspapers. People started calling the house, My mother said that all America was calling the house.
Jimmy Kutcher's case started before McCarthy came into it and ended after, but it was possibly the worst outrage of the whole time. I always hate to say that anything was the worst, but I really believe that the disability pension hearing was the lowest point of that period.
They had tried everything they could to terrorize and silence Kutcher. Fired him from his job, took away his pension, tried to throw him out of his house, harassed his aged parents, everything they could think of. But Jimmy stood firm and he fought.
So just a couple of weeks before Christmas in 1955, I believe it was, we walked into the Veterans Administration, into a hearing room where there was a very dignified looking hearing examiner. And so I naturally, as a lawyer, said to him, what are the rules by which we will be governed in this hearing? He said, what? In a very understanding way. He couldn't understand what I was asking. I says, we got to have some rules for a hearing. And finally he said, in this wonderful Alice in Wonderland way, I'll make the rules as we go along.
Don't forget, by this time, the Kutcher fight is 7 years along. And everybody in the country knows about it. And the press was there en masse, the newspapers, television, radio, and there was tremendous sympathy right in the hearing room, beginning with the press itself on Jimmy's side. And everything that happened there was going out before the whole country.
He claimed that Jimmy, by a speech several years earlier, had given aid and comfort to the North Koreans. The picture of a legless veteran giving aid and comfort to soldiers over on the battlefield in North Korea was one of the most ridiculous things I've ever heard in my life.
It is further stated here, at which time you stated that you like the red system of government, that in this country half of what a worker earns goes to the government, and under the red government the worker gets all he earns, that the government of the United States is composed of people who are cheaters and crooks who oppress the working people. Did you make any of those statements?
No, sir.
It continues. It is further shown that you urged and advocated that the members in attendance at the camp cause strikes and get in key positions and get the Socialist Workers' Party in control of the government of the United States. Did you make that statement?
No, sir.
Have you ever knowingly, consciously rendered assistance to an enemy of the United States or of its allies?
No, sir.
Now, these witch hunters are a sleazy lot. They're not interested in the truth at all. They try to twist and distort everything you say to make it appear that you believe the opposite of what you say you believe, to trick and entrap. There isn't a grain of honesty in them anywhere. They got a job to do, and they don't care whose character they assassinate in the process. But here again, they ran up against a stone wall. Jimmy, in that hearing, in his own inimitable way, simply told about his beliefs.
Well, I believe that we should have a socialist society with planned production for use instead of profit. That this society come into being through the organization of a labor party, the election of a labor, former labor government, and that's about the gist of it.
And after they tried to trick and entrap Jimmy, they tried to bribe him. If he would recant his views, he could have his job, his pension, one thing or another. He turned that down, spurned all that, stood by his principles. And so the government found itself in an untenable position, and it had to back off. And it had to capitulate all up and down the line and correct, make amends for all the injustices that had been committed against Jimmy. It
took ten years before to get the job back and make a final settlement in the question of back pay. I never thought I would win it. From the beginning, I never thought that I'd win it. I was just fighting because I thought it was the thing to do was to fight.
And now, returning to national news, unnamed sources in the Reagan administration are circulating proposals that would allow the CIA to spy on U.S. citizens. Under this plan, the CIA would be allowed to conduct break-ins and infiltrate domestic political groups. This comes at a time when conservatives in Congress are calling for new committees to investigate alleged foreign terrorist activity. In December, Senate Judiciary Chair Strom Thurmond announced formation of a new subcommittee on security and terrorism. And papers now circulating on Capitol Hill indicate supposed terrorist sympathizers may be the object of new investigations, just as alleged communists were singled out 30 years ago. Civil liberties groups warn that peace organizations, anti-nuclear protesters, and even reporters investigating issues like U.S. intervention in El Salvador could be prime targets of government harassment.